Hi, I'm Rex Black, president of RBCS. Welcome to the RBCS YouTube channel. Hey, I hope you enjoy all these free resources that are available here. And do us one favor. We need to keep the lights on, and we need your help to do that. So when you need testing and quality-related services, training, consulting, expert services, you name it, let us be one of the bidders on that next job. We don't expect to get all of your business, but we'd like to get a chance. Thanks, and enjoy the shows.
Might get along together, but they're not necessarily very good. They're following the same process as the adults, but they make a lot of mistakes, right? So, similarly, it's not enough to have people following good process and doing some of the things that I've talked about before if they don't know how to do them right. You have to have good skills. So, if your job is managing quality, then you have to make sure that the skills of the people building the software are also being managed. They know what they need to know to do this. Now, skills assessment, this is not, again, not a revolutionary idea. If you happen to see my book, Managing a Testing Process, there's a discussion in there about how to identify through what's called task analysis what the critical skills are within your team. Need to know to do what they need to do, and then you can rate people on their level of skill, and you can find gaps and you can improve it. Again, this is well-established human resources stuff. I didn't invent this technique for the book. I just included it in the book. We know how to do this. We just need to do it. We also need to be serious about how long does it take to get good. There's stuff that's hard to do. Malcolm Gladwell published a book called Outliers. I don't know if you've read that or seen it. Some people like Malcolm Gladwell's writing, some people don't. But in this book, he makes a very interesting observation. The book is about what makes people successful. And so he looks at a lot of different factors that are involved in becoming a successful person. One of the things it looks at is how long does it take to master something? How long does it take to become an expert? And what he found is, there's a magic number here, 10,000 hours. Any sort of intellectually complex task, playing a piano, writing software, running performance tests, doing test automation, any intellectually complex task would take you about 10,000 hours to become. 10,000 hours is about 5 years. Okay? So let's be realistic about what it means to be an expert. I've seen some skills assessments done where people will count themselves as being experts in something, and I would say, well, how many years of experience do you have? Oh, 6 months. I'm sorry, you're not an expert. Unless something's trivial, you're not going to be an expert at it in 6 months. All right, so let me give you case studies here again, success and failure. I've been kind of picking on other people's failures and other people's mistakes a little bit, so I'm going to pick on myself. You know, again, it's discipline. We got to have discipline. And I'm not perfect either. I make mistakes, and here's an example of having made a mistake. 2007, we hired a company to rebuild our website. And we used a marketing firm to help us do this. And I trusted the marketing firm to pick out the company that we were going to use to rebuild our website, assuming that they would do careful reference checking and skills checking and so forth. Because I was busy. We use that rationalization, don't we? I'm too busy. Right? I know you've heard it. Oh yeah, I know, I'm supposed to unit test the code, but I'm too busy. The testers will find the problems later in system test anyway. And I mean, if I had, you know, 10 euros for every time I heard that rationalization and criticized it, I'd have a lot of money. So you'd think I would know better than to make that mistake myself, but no, I did. I said, I'm too busy to check out this firm. I'm sure the marketing people have checked them out. I'm sure they'll be fine. Nope. It was not fine. simple website. We don't have a complicated website for our company. It's a fairly simple website. But it took over 4 months to finish the development. Most of that time was bug fixing and testing. And after development, we had tons of quality problems. And worse, we had lock-in with this company because they used proprietary technology. Again, you know, this is discipline, and the problem is that we get lazy. We try to take shortcuts, and there aren't any. And you know, I've seen them with my clients, and this time I got to learn the lesson firsthand by making the same mistake myself. Okay, so 2 years later, we had reached the boiling point with this whole website situation. So we hired another company, a company called Stevens & Stevens, which does the work for the American Software Testing Quality, Testing Qualification Board's website. And I knew that they were good. And we basically had the same requirements, the same development and test process, but so everything's the same. The team is different. The development team is different. Now, I wouldn't say that this went perfectly, that there weren't any bugs, there weren't any problems, but it was a lot better. And the website is still a lot better, and we continue to use these folks. Okay. The difference, the only difference between the development work of the website that we did in 2007 and the development work in 2009, three people. Three people with the skills. The second time, three people without the skills. First time, okay, and that was the difference. That was skills. So, gotta use the right people. Now, turnover is something to watch out for. Okay, when you're managing skills, you gotta watch out for turnover because now you got new people coming in, and you've got both known and unknown skills gaps. So keep your people. Tom DeMarco, in one of his books, said, he made an interesting point that you know, you see companies that lay off their staff, and a lot of times their stock price goes up. People say, stock traders say, these people are making, these companies are making tough decisions, and they're managing carefully. And DeMarco said, no, you know, they shouldn't actually be rewarded for that. They should pay a price for that because think of when you do a layoff, think of all the intellectual capital that's walking out the door. And you lose a lot of money that was invested in ramping people up. So turnover is a problem. Turnover is it's a cost issue, but it's also a quality issue. Don't make outsourcing decisions without being careful, without assessing the people. That was the big mistake that I made to be avoided. Okay, so manage change. I picked this as the last one, just because to some extent it's topical. A change is going to happen, right? We are going to have change. But doesn't mean that because we're going to have change, we should just totally abandon the concept of managing change. I mean, there's smart change and there's stupid change. And there's change properly managed and there's change not properly managed. And you can see the difference. Organizations making smart choices versus organizations that just thrash around. Oh, here's a new feature. Let's put the new feature in. Maybe we should think about what the implications of that are. So we've got to understand what's the impact? What are the implications of the change? We have to remember every change has costs and risks as well as opportunities and benefits. It's all too easy for people to fixate on the opportunities and benefits. Okay? But let's also remember we need to think about costs and risks. Okay, so we saw this happen on one project during the user acceptance test. The users were we're told. Anything you don't like, report it as a bug, we'll fix it. No document requirements. The original plan, UAT, was supposed to be 6 weeks. Users reported over 800 bugs during user acceptance test. 800 bugs. That's not good. We're not talking about a particularly large project here. 800 bugs. And most of these were not actually bugs. They were just change requests. They were just, he said, anything I don't like, report it as a bug. Okay, here you go. 800 things I don't like. So UAT stretched out to 12 weeks, so there we've got a 100% schedule overrun on UAT. 100%. That's not good. And project failed. So change management, major cause of that failure. So we know how to do this. Again, this is another discipline issue. So system testing on another project that we worked on for a client, cross-functional team doing triage of bugs and evaluation of proposed changes. Cross-functional team looking at the proposed changes, assessing risks, costs, opportunities, and benefits, having a discussion, mature discussion about, okay, why should we do this? Why shouldn't we do this? Let's throw it in the balance pans and see what makes sense. Let's allow more change earlier during testing because we can deal with the risk, but less at the end because the risks go up, right? The risks associated with the change are not the same throughout the life cycle, are they? Risks are going to go up as we get closer to release date. Let's recognize that. So on this project, we had mature decisions being made, and the project was a success. Okay. So I've offered 6 things that I would suggest you look at. Look at those 6 lessons. How well, how poorly do you do those things? Do you have the right people? Do you manage change? Do you have good requirements? Are there common mistakes that you're making? A lot of the stuff that I described, the mistakes were pretty straightforward, weren't they? I wasn't talking about things where you had to have 17 different things go wrong before the thing resulted in project failure. These are pretty straightforward 1-2 factor kinds of things. So look at it. Now, are you making these mistakes? Are some of the tips for success that I've mentioned? Because you apply some of those. On the first slide, why should we care? I hope that you could all relate to that. This does matter. Do we know how to deal with this? Do we know how to do better? Yes, we do. Those 6 things that I talked about, these are not secrets. These are not things that nobody's ever heard of before, right? These are things that we know. We just need to do it. So figure out where you are, assess, and then be disciplined. Make the changes that you need to make. You can build better software. All build better software. We should start to hold ourselves as an industry to the expectation that we must build better software because it's becoming more and more critical every day. Just as a society, as a global economy, we can't afford to go through the next 40 years with the kind of lousy software that we put up with. First 50 years or so of computerization, we can't afford it. We need that to change now because everything's connected to everything else, and when software fails now, it's not an isolated thing. Okay. Right? Do we have time for some questions?
Yeah, please. Yeah, I have time for a few questions. You may have seen Rex until next year this time, so please ask some questions. Do you have these ones?
My name is Boris Schubler. You several times talked about skills, and you said we have the skills, we know what to do, what we want to do.
Yeah. We don't necessarily have the skill.
that's my question. Yeah. What, which skills should a tester have? You talk about reducing risks in early phases, for example, by simulation.
Yeah.
Or also other techniques like formal verification, some analyzing for deadlocks or other properties. Can we use testers? Which skills do you need as testers?
The specific set of skills that you're going to need will tend to vary from one project to the next, depending on the technology and the application domain and the kind of testing that you're doing, right? So the way you determine that is it's referred to as a job analysis or a task analysis, where you go through and you look at what are the different tasks that you as a tester or your test team will have to carry out during this project. And then you ask yourself, what skills would a tester need to have in order to do that? So if, for example, in your project, your performance is a big risk, so you want to do a lot of performance simulation early in the project, then you need to have somebody in the project who understands how to do performance simulation, right? So that's a critical skill on your project. So I think you need to do that analysis to determine what the skills are. Now, some of this stuff I think is clear, you know, as Ray mentioned, I've invested a lot of my own personal time and energy in the ISDQB program as a volunteer, because I do believe that there are core fundamental ideas that are reflected in the foundation and the advanced syllabus that every tester should know. So I think that stuff is easy. You don't need to do a complex task analysis to know that every tester on your team at least ought to be able to understand things like boundary value analysis and how to write a bug report and how testing fits into the software development lifecycle process. But I think, you know, if you're a test manager or a quality assurance manager, you do need to go through this process of assessing the skills of your team and what skills they really need to have, and, you know, having the discipline to manage that. But yeah, I want to be clear. When I said we know how to do this stuff, what I meant was that all of the things that I talked about are pretty well understood of why they're important. Now, knowing that we need to do things and having the skills to be able to do them are two different things. So, you know, that's why, you know, we have to build those skills within our teams. But none of the stuff that I talked about is a mystery. You know, it's just discipline and doing it.
And that was
a
question.
Yeah.
My name is Lucia Gates-Lugler. In your presentation, you mentioned about employees walking out of the company, with their experience. And what do you think about changing project members during a project? What's your experience about? What do you think about it? Is it something good, or so we avoid that in projects? Changing project members for something good. Thank you.
Thanks. Good question. Obviously, there are some situations where you've got somebody on the project who needs to not be on the project for one reason or another. This isn't always a skills issue, though it can be. Sometimes it's an attitude issue. Somebody's just, they're a problem, they're a source of contention and difficulty within the project. They need to be removed from the project. But anytime you do that, you remove somebody, then you bring someone new in, you know, and this goes all the way back to Fred Brooks and the Mythical Man Month. You know, that person who's been brought in now doesn't know the project. They don't know what they're doing. They can't contribute on the first day, right? So there's a ramp-up period. And this Tom DeMarco concept that I talked about, he said, a simple way of doing this is assume that on the first day that somebody starts on a project, they are 0% effective. In other words, they can't contribute anything, right? And then there's a ramp-up period, and at the end of that ramp-up period, they're 100% effective. So you can assume if it's a straight-line ramp-up, on average, that person is 50% effective. So let's say that the ramp-up period is 3 months. It takes 3 months for a new person brought onto a project to become 100% effective. Okay. So during that three-month period, that person's going to work 3 months, right? So now we have 3 person months of effort that person is putting in. But in terms of effective effort, we only actually get 1.5 person months of work out of that person, because on average they were 50% effective. And again, this isn't my concept. This is a Tom DeMarco thing. I remember reading it in this book, and that's just brilliant. It's just a brilliant way of thinking about it. And so you are effectively reducing the staff level of your project team invisibly when turnover occurs within the project team during the project. And then this leads to Fred Brooks' observation in The Mythical Mammoth, which is sometimes referred to as Brooks' Law. Adding more people to a late project makes it even later, because those people don't add anywhere near the kind of effort you think they're going to add. They have to be ramped up, and who's ramping them up? Other members of the project team. So the net effective staff level of your project team when you add somebody goes down. You know, you just look at the headcount, you go, oh, you know, headcount went up. Or if you replace somebody, you go, the headcount stayed the same. The headcount stayed the same. But remember, this is brain work that we're doing. This is not shoveling sand. You know, shoveling a big pile of sand, the more people you put around the pile of sand, the shovels, the faster the level of the sand goes down, right? But that's not what we're doing. And we make the mistake, as managers in software projects, of assuming that we're doing something that's like shoveling sand. We gotta get out of that mindset. And again, this is not a mystery. This is Fred Brooks' Mythical Mammoth, published in 1975. I've been in this business a while, but I wasn't even in this business in 1975. You know, so this is stuff that we know. We just need to be disciplined. And we need to look at turnover as a symptom of a problem that is going to corrode the effectiveness and efficiency of our teams. And that's, I think, the way that we ought to see it. Thank you for that question. I love getting into that topic because it's just such a critical